Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you.
Welcome to John Live!
There's a city that calls me by name. There's a city that calls me by name. Yes, as I run this race, I am cheered by the saints. There's a city that calls me by name. There's a future that runs through my veins. There's a future that runs through my veins. And there's nothing on earth that can stand in the way. There's a future that runs through my veins. Everywhere I go on this road, high and low.
Song we could ever sing, worthy of all the praise we could ever bring, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Yeah. Jesus, the name above every other name, Jesus, the only one that could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to the.
Oh,
Well, it's great to be with everyone today. We're going to go ahead and continue in our series here in a moment. Can you believe we're in September? Yeah, fall is definitely in the air. It's actually my favorite time of the year, possibly yours as well. I don't know. But anyway, we want to talk about virtue signals. We've been seeing a lot of that over the last really 18 months, even beyond that. Basically, you know, where people are, you know, whereas virtues are good, we have people virtue signaling, you know, basically their judgments on, you know, that something is bad or whatnot. And when they do that, they're really trying to make themselves look good or virtuous by making those declarations. And sometimes I think it's truthful, but other times, not so much. And we learn from Scripture to be careful in that area. Because in 1 Samuel 16, 7, the last part of the verse, we learn something about the Lord. It says the Lord doesn't see things the way you see them, the way I see them. People judge by outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. Yeah, he looks at our heart. So as Christ followers, we want to be more than superficial, right? Superficial appearance type of thing. We want to actually be virtuous. Yeah, we want to be virtuous. We want to be like our Lord and Savior. We want to be like Jesus. And when we let him into our lives, he can direct us and cause us to grow and become virtuous in a lot of different areas. Today, we're going to explore a new virtue here. So I need you to do a drum roll. If you're at home, you can do it on the coffee table. Or if you're in the car on the dashboard, but hang on, well, maybe not. Keep your hands on the wheel. Anyway, a drum roll. Here's our new virtue. It is service. Service. You might be thinking, service? I didn't even know service was a virtue. Oh, absolutely. An important, important one. You know, before COVID-19 hit us, stats revealed that approximately 10% of the American church were actively serving. Only 10%. Think about that. That's 90% of the people are not serving. That's kind of sad, isn't it? And of course, I can't imagine what those stats would be now after all that we've gone through. Maybe it's like, I don't know, maybe it's 2 or 3, at best 5% are actually serving now. Think if it's 3, 97% of the people aren't serving. That's troubling, isn't it? And it is troubling because of this reason, Jesus was all about serving. So that's troubling. Jesus was all about serving, and really, so were his followers in that first century and beyond. You know, pandemic or not, Jesus' people should step up and make a difference. That's who we are. Christians, you know, don't hide out until they feel safe, at least not historically. They rush in to serve those that are in need, those that are hurting. You know, Napoleon once pointed to a map, to China on a map, and he said, "There lies a sleeping giant. If it ever wakes up, it will be unstoppable." When I was thinking about that, I would say the same is true, really, for the church. If the church in the United States alone, you know, I think it's a sleeping giant. I think it really is. And if it ever wakes up, if the church ever wakes up, it will be unstoppable. That is, if it ever wakes up. It will be unstoppable. And you say, well, unstoppable. What do you mean by unstoppable? What's it going to do? Unstoppable carriers of hope. Of hope. Many feel hopeless today. And Christ followers have the answer in Jesus. Jesus, what? He brings hope to the world and to people in need, and they need to hear that message so desperately
right now. So the church needs to wake up. Yes. Our mission here at the church is to connect all generations to Christ through loving, growing, and serving. You know, loving God and loving others, growing in God with others, serving God by serving others. And so to do that, I'm excited to kind of begin getting it out there that this fall, we're going to launch a new initiative called Project Hope. Yeah, bringing hope to people's lives. I think we got a big logo there for you to look at. Project Hope. You know, moving forward, we're going to be all about reaching, rescuing, and restoring people's lives. I'm going to instruct my staff, the lead team, everyone, that basically we need to figure out ways to bring hope, the hope of Jesus, to people's lives. And the virtue of service will be a key component in whether this initiative is successful or not. I believe it's going to be successful. This church family is being called upon to join together to serve Jesus by serving others. Some of you are familiar with the word ministry, no doubt. Well, the Bible, another word for ministry within the Bible is the word serve. Serve. The New Testament word for ministry is diakonia, and it simply means service. Yeah, it means service. Here at the church, we use the word serve probably more than we do minister or ministry. We use those two, but we probably use service more. Simply put, serve means to be useful. To be useful, which begs the question, doesn't it, of all of us? Are we useful? Are we useful to the Lord? Are we available to Jesus and to his body, the church? I mean, it's the reason Christians are still here and not in heaven. You know, Jesus could save us and take us straight to heaven, but we're left here to be useful for God's purposes. There's a job to do. Mark 10:45 talks about that job where Jesus said, "For even the Son of Man, Jesus, came not to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." We read in Romans 15, verses 2 and through 3 here, it says, "Those of us who are strong and able in the faith need to step in and lend a hand to those who falter, and not just do what is most convenient for us. Strength is for," get this, "serving," it says. It's for serving, not status. Each one of us needs to look after the good of the people around us, asking ourselves, how can I help? When's the last time you said, how can I help? How can I help? That's exactly what Jesus did, it goes on to say. He didn't make it easy for himself by avoiding people's troubles, but waded right in and helped out. "I took on the troubles of the troubled," is the way scripture puts it. So in other words, service demands getting wet. Yeah, it demands wading in to help others out. Somebody's out there drowning. You have to wade in, swim out, get wet, right? If they're out in the muck, you got to wade in and get dirty to help people out. And as we're learning with all these virtues, really, they are best demonstrated, right? They're best demonstrated, not merely proclaimed as, say, in a virtue signal type of thing. Jesus demonstrated service. Yeah, he demonstrated service. And so did the early church. So we're going to go ahead and read a story from the early church here. And before we do, we're going to make our declaration. So if you love God's word, hold it up or hold up your technology that has God's word in it. And let's just say it together, right? Repeat after me. I love God's word. It feeds me. It guides me. It directs me. And let that be the case. Let it direct us here today. All right, Acts 6:1-7 says, "In those days when the number of disciples was increasing, the Hellenistic Jews among them complained against the Hebraic Jews because their widows were being overlooked in the daily distribution of food. So the 12 gathered all the disciples together and said, "It would not be right for us to neglect the ministry of the word of God in order to wait on tables. Brothers and sisters, choose 7 men from among you who are known to be full of the Spirit and wisdom. We will turn this responsibility over to them and will give our attention to prayer and the ministry of the word." This proposal pleased the whole group. They chose Stephen, a man full of faith and of the Holy Spirit, also Philip, Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenas, and Nicholas from Antioch, a convert to Judaism. They presented these men to the apostles who prayed and laid their hands on them. So the word of God spread. The number of disciples in Jerusalem increased rapidly, and a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Well, let's unpack this just a little bit. In this Bible story, we find what? We find a problem that's happening, and we also find a solution, right? The problem is lack of care. Not everyone is being cared for. The solution to that problem is what? Service. Yeah, it's service. So what's happening in this story and what's not happening in this story? The early church was really made up at this point. It's made up of 2 different groups of Jews that have become Christ followers, okay? So you have the Hebraic Jews who had come to Christ as, you know, had become Christ followers, and they spoke Hebrew or Aramaic, and they were raised in Israel, and they knew the land, and they knew the customs and all of that. By contrast, you have the Hellenistic Jews, who also had become Christians. They were Grecian Jews. They were Jewish Christians who spoke Greek, okay? They had been born outside of Israel. And when they came to Christ, they brought their Greek-speaking culture with them. And so you have really, excuse me, kind of 2 cultures, you know, running headlong into each other. Now, here's the problem. The Hebrew or Aramaic-speaking widows were being favored. Yeah, even back then, this stuff went on. This isn't like new. This is like human stuff, right? Human nature, fallen nature in some cases. They were being favored over the Greek-speaking widows. So this was a big deal because it was not in keeping, of course, with the virtues of Christ Jesus. So the church leaders come together to find a solution. That's exactly what's going on. The disciples said, you know what? We need to be giving ourselves to the word so we can teach, and we need to be in prayer and all those sorts of things. Meaning the others would need to step up now and serve to help the widows that are being overlooked and all of that. In other words, there's so much to do, and it takes many to get it all done. Some things never change, right? It'd be like kind of like this, like Russell Wilson, right? He can't throw a pass and then run out and receive it. You know, he needs others. He needs others serving. He needs others being receivers, others blocking, so he can get the pass off, that's been a problem in recent years. But anyway, right, he needs others to make it all happen. It's kind of like Pete Carroll. He can't be coaching and handing out Gatorade at the same time. Well, I guess he could, but he wouldn't be a very good coach. He'd be distracted, right? Now, one thing about Carroll, he can coach and chew gum at the same time. That guy can really chew gum, can't he? But anyway, you get my point. The apostles couldn't focus on their area of service and also feed the widows. Both are important. This isn't about importance of ministry. It's about people doing what they're called to. And the same is true in the church today. Are you following me? Sherry and I have many, many responsibilities, whether it's Sunday morning worship service or leading the staff or the board or preaching or teaching or casting vision. And really, the list goes on and on from there. But to serve well in that way, we can't serve in the nursery, say, at the same time. Although I think throughout the years, we've probably given that a chance. We try, you know, type of thing, but we can't do it. We can't play the guitar. You wouldn't want to hear me anyway, but we can't play the guitar, make the coffee, and sanitize all the surfaces while preaching the word or leading worship. You just can't do it. If we did, we'd look like the guy that we saw at the Evergreen State Fair. I think there's a pic for you to look at there. Yeah, that's not the guy at the fair, but it looks just like him. The one-man band, right? Pretty cool to watch, kind of funny to watch, but it's probably not the best strategy to carry out God's mission. Yeah. God created us for his mission. We are created, what? In the image of God. Imago Dei, image of God, right? We're created that way. And within that, we discover we are actually created to serve. Did you know that? We are created to serve. Yet our broken, sinful nature constantly, you know, pulls away from that, strays from that. You know, we're created to do our own thing, you know, and put all our priorities first and all that kind of stuff and protect our time and whatever it is. But that's not why we're created. We're created for service. Henry Van Dyke writes in 1897, check this out, listen on purpose. The search for pleasure, wealth, and fame often leads to frustration. It seems the more we get, the more we want. To be useful, what's that? That's service. To be useful is a goal that brings rewards far beyond earthly pleasures. Oh, so true. Could it be that our pursuits for other things, almost every other thing, keeps us from our pursuit of God, which actually brings true happiness and fulfillment? You know, writer Elaine Wright Colvin speaks to this in her book, Treasury of God's Virtues. And she says, in essence, this. She says, to be in service to the world, to aim to live in a way that increases the happiness and welfare and virtue of humanity is the choice we must all make. We must all make. What is she saying? Think about it. She's saying that usefulness and serving is our calling by God. It's our calling by God. She's saying that wealth comes from the reward for usefulness. That's true wealth. That pleasure comes from living with purpose. That's true godly pleasure. That fame comes from service and the gratitude that it brings. Yeah. When we choose to serve God, in other words, by serving others, everything else has its way of falling into place and true happiness comes into our lives and fulfillment. And it's important that we understand that service, making ourselves what? Making ourselves useful for God's purposes is also actually worship. Service is worship. Service to God is worship. I don't know if you ever thought, oftentimes we just think of worship as the songs we sing. That's a part of worship. But service is worship. Romans 12, 1 says it so well in the NLT. It says, and so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. Now, watch this. This is truly the way to worship him. As we give our lives, as we serve him, that's the way we worship him. Another version, the NASB, says it this way, to present your bodies a living and holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. Still another version says your reasonable service. Yeah, there it all is. So the person who prepares the morning coffee, the person who picks up the donuts, by the way, with our new donut coffee time, we're looking to build some teams to make that all happen. We need some people serving. Yeah, those people that make the coffee and pick up the donuts, those are acts of worship. Yeah. The person who greeted you this morning, greets you, you know, when you come into the service or, you know, whatever it is, or, you know, the person that helps you find a seat or answers a question here at the church, you know, or changes the light bulbs or weeds the yard or, you know, whatever it is, that's worship. That's where, when that's done for God, that's worship. The team of people who are with our, you know, that are our youth, our leaders, you know, they're worshiping God as they serve our students. When a baby is rocked in the nursery or a preschool is read a book in kids' life, that's an act of worship on that person's part. Yeah, those ministering to our kids, you know, in our church service, we have people ministering to our kids. It's an act of worship. It's an act of worship. They're not just, you know, getting plugged into a spot. No, it's an act of worship. You see, believers express worship through service. Did you know that? Service inside the church facility, outside the church facility. Doesn't matter. It's all worship. The Apostle Paul reminded the Colossian believers this. In Colossians 3:17, he says, and whatever you do, that he's talking about service, right? Whatever you do or say, do it as a representative of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks through him to God the Father. So it's an act of worship. When your service is for Jesus, yeah, it's worship. Jesus says in Matthew 5:13, you are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It's no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. Well, what's this about? Salt in Jesus' day was, of course, like now, it was a seasoning, yes. But even more important, it was a preservative, and it was used to prevent food from what? From decaying. Yeah, that was its primary use, actually. Jesus' meaning here is Christians are to serve or engage those around them, their culture, in order to prevent its decay. Service. Pastor Jeremiah and Chuck Whitfield, member here at the church, they serve on the Monroe School Board. And that service is actually an act of worship. I know they do that because they want to serve the Lord. They want to serve God in every way they can. The Bible says Jesus came to serve our broken world. Christ followers are to serve our world as well in whatever way God calls us, right? Consider Paul's words to the Romans, Romans 12, 4 and 5. He says, just as our bodies have many parts and each part has a special function. In other words, you know, you got a hand, you got a foot, you got a tongue, you got ears, and they all have a special function, right? So it is with Christ's body, all of us. We are many parts of one body and we belong to each other. So what's going on here when we think of service? We all have unique giftings and different functions or ways of serving, different ways of serving, and together God's purposes are brought forth. The kingdom of God advances. God is honored as we serve together. We are part of God's great plan then to bring the hope of Jesus to our world. And we share in that mission, don't we? When we serve, we share in it. Do you know that you are created to serve? You and I are created to serve. Yeah. Ephesians 2:10 says, for we are God's masterpiece. He has created us anew in Christ Jesus, new life in Jesus, right? Why? So we can do the good things he planned for us long ago. Yeah, so we can serve. Yeah, we are not created to live our lives pursuing, you know, earthly pleasure and wealth and fame for ourselves. No, we're here to serve God. As believers, we are created in Christ Jesus to serve God in this world. Yeah, created to serve. You're created to serve. And by the way, we are also saved to serve. Now, I know Jesus forgives us of our sins and we're saved and we're given that wonderful gift of eternal life. I don't minimize that at all. Do you not need to know that we're actually saved to serve as well? 2 Timothy 1:9 says, for God saved us and called us to live a holy life. which speaks really of living out the purposes of God, service. He did this not because we deserved it, but because that was his plan from before the beginning of time to show us his grace through Christ Jesus. In other words, let me simplify, Jesus didn't die on the cross so that we could sit around and do nothing. No. Jesus didn't give it all so that we could sit, you know, in a church facility only and go to a service or watch online once a week. Those are important, but that's not what it's all about. You have been saved to serve, to be working for the restoration of lives, seeking and saving the lost with the uniqueness of how God made you. That's what Jesus was all about. We're also called to serve. We are called to serve. 1 Peter 2:9, for you are a chosen people. In other words, we're called. You are royal priests, a holy nation, God's very own possession. As a result, you can show others the goodness of God. How? Through service. Through service. For he called you out of the darkness into his wonderful light. The phrase "you are chosen" implies calling of service and purpose. All believers are called to serve. There's no one exempt, okay? There's no one exempt. And then we are equipped to serve. We're all these things. We're equipped to serve. 1 Peter 4:10, God has given each of you a gift from his great variety of spiritual gifts. Use them well to, here it is, to serve one another. Wow, this is probably perhaps it's the clearest statement in the New Testament that every Christian has received a spiritual gift to serve. So when you invite Jesus into your life and he regenerates your life through the work of the Holy Spirit, we're given gifts, and we're given those gifts to serve, that we've been equipped with ability and power to serve God and serve others, equipped so that we can accomplish Jesus' purposes. He can accomplish his purposes through our lives. So you just have to ask yourself, what am I, you say, well, how do I serve you? What are you good at, right? What do you enjoy? Because God works within that. What skills or talents do you have that could be used for Jesus in service? And even more, you might say, I don't know what that would be. You know, all of us have potential. Yeah, so what would you be interested in? There's a reason why God probably put that there. You can always shadow even a person at the church if you don't know. Just follow them around while they do ministry on a particular week. Get an idea. Is that something I'd be interested in? And maybe it's no, maybe it's yeah, I think I could do that. Right, that kind of thing. Learn more about it. Ephesians 4, 11 and 12. I know I have a lot of scripture today, but it's important. It says, now these are the gifts Christ gave to the church, the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, and the pastors and teachers. Their responsibility, this is my responsibility, the lead team's responsibility, the staff's responsibility. Their responsibility is to equip God's people. That's my responsibility, to equip God's people for what? It goes on to say, to do his work. That's service. And build up the church, the body of Christ. You see, at some point you just simply say, yes, I will serve. I might not have it all figured out yet, but I will serve and just make yourself available. And when you do that, you can learn, you can grow, and you'll eventually serve. You can become effective in for the Lord, whether you're serving inside or outside the church. The staff's responsibility is to come alongside of you. The lead team comes alongside to invest in you so that you can find that place to serve Jesus, because we all should be serving. The lead team serves to equip you. Is that making sense? And help you discover the best fit for serving. That's their service. That's my service, right? Understand, we don't want to just fill a spot. We want to get you, for God's purposes, into your sweet spot. Yeah, into your sweet spot. To serve and help, you know, so that you can serve and worship in that way. And then finally, we are empowered and commanded to serve. Man, it's pretty, there's a lot there, isn't there? Matthew 28, 18 and 19, the Great Commission, here quoted a lot, right? Jesus came and told his disciples, I've been given all authority in heaven and on earth. That's power. That's authority. And then he says, therefore, go. He commands us, right? Go and make disciples. Go serve. Make disciples of all nations, baptize in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. God the Father gave authority to his Son, and now the Son has given authority to his church to serve him. Who's the church? We are the church. If you're a believer, you are the church. When we serve Jesus, no matter what form it takes, we do so in the Lord's authority and with his command to go forth. In faith, we can seek the infilling power of the Holy Spirit and see heaven come down and do stuff through us we never thought imaginable. When we serve, that's when those things happen, when we serve. Jesus clearly instructs us to serve, and he modeled a life of service. Who could forget the image of him, you know, putting a towel around his waist and taking that form of a servant, washing his disciples' feet, and basically saying, you know, if you want to be a part of the church, if you want to lead the church, you need to be a servant. You need to serve, right? Because we've been created, we've been saved, we've been called, we've been gifted, we've been empowered, and we've been commanded to serve. So let's serve the Lord. Yeah, let's serve the Lord. Ralph Waldo Emerson, who I love, once said, "The purpose of life is not to be happy. It's to be useful." What is that? That's service. It's to be useful, to be honorable, to be compassionate, to have it make some difference that you lived and lived well. Are you living well for the Lord? Are you useful because you choose to serve in his name? It could be that you're already serving, and if you are, kudos to you. Thank you so very much. And even more important, Jesus thanks you. Or you're serving, but it's just not the right fit. Maybe it's time to explore some other, you know, maybe areas, some other opportunities where there'd be a little more joy to it. Maybe you've never served, or you once served, and you're not serving now. Whatever the case is for you, it's time to take your place. It's time to get off the bench. It's time to step into the family and do your part. It's time to be more like Jesus. Absolutely. It's time to serve. It's time to join the team. How else can I say it? Remember what happened in our story earlier when more people began to serve? What happened? More people came to Christ. More people were one to Jesus. The church was more united. There's something that happens when the more people you have serving, the more united you become as well. No one can do everything. That's just it. Nobody can do everything, but everybody can do something. What is that something that God wants to do through you? How will you serve the Lord? Today, I want to invite you to check out our serve card. It looks like this. If you were here at the church, it would be in the chair in front of you, but you can go online. It says love, grow, and then pronounce serve. And then on the back here, it says serve. And what we want you to do is fill out your name, your email, your phone number, as much information as you're willing. What campus you go to, or maybe you go to both, I don't know. Frequency that you want to serve. Maybe it's weekly or twice a month or once a month or other. Areas of service, welcome team, coffee service, and it goes on and on, kids' life, all sorts of different things there. And maybe the one that area you want to serve isn't there, so you could just put unknown, but I want to serve, you know, or something like that. And we'll make sure we get back to you and try to get you plugged in, because remember, serving is worship, and we want you to be worshiping with your all your life, with your whole self, amen? Worshiping the Lord. Well, today is a special day. And so before I make an announcement, let's just pray about what we've talked about. Can we do that? Father, we thank you that you demonstrated your great love for us by sending Jesus, Jesus, you express your love for us by coming to our earth and giving your own life for us. When we look to you, we find the most amazing examples of love expressed through action and service. Help us to truly take our place now within the family of faith. Help us to join the team, to begin to serve. We know that we have been created, saved, called, gifted, empowered, and commanded to serve. And we want to respond to that. And so we respond by saying, yes, yes, I'll serve. We surrender to your will and your ways. We express our worship through service as we move forward. Amen. Amen. Well, speaking of service, today I'm so excited to welcome, you know, onto our team two fantastic people. And we're, you know, if you were here, we'd have them come forward and all of that during our church service. But we'll put their pictures up for you. Marjorie Campbell will be serving as our new children's director. Excited about it. Jeremiah Campbell will be serving in a newly created position that I've wanted filled for a long time as our family life pastor. He's going to be in charge of all the spiritual formation here at the church. It's going to be good. Jeremiah and Marge grew up in the Pacific Northwest, so they know our culture, and they come with a wealth of ministry experience, both in the local church and then as AG missionaries to Bolivia for 10 years. So they, you know, God's used them in great ways. Jeremiah has earned his doctorate, and both of them now currently serve as public school teachers. They have two wonderful children, Judah and Michaela. And most importantly, they are fully devoted Christ followers, and they want to serve. They want to serve. So I know you're at home watching this or somewhere watching this, but join me in just welcoming them onto our leadership team and into our family of faith. And next time you're at the church, make sure you stop and greet them and welcome them and all of that good stuff. Well, all of you out there, find a way to serve this week and have a wonderful week in Jesus as you worship him through your service. God bless you.
Everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. So I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may, where I go with you. Oh, everywhere I go on this road, high and low, where I go with you. So I won't be afraid, this my hope, come what may. Where I go with you. I go with you. Where I go, I go with you.